Thank you for the invitation and for your kind words. Did you see? It's the second tie today.
Ah, second tie.
The second tie today. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to be here, because today I learned more than on a regular orthopedic congress. This is our group, and I want especially to thank the four first mentioned people, because they had to discuss all these topics with 10 orthopedic surgeons from all the university hospitals in the Netherlands. And you can see there are some spine surgeons and some pediatric surgeons, and also two surgeons, this one who works in an academic hospital and also in a private practice. So it's a good combination for just the orthopedic practice in the Netherlands. The topics I want to discuss is a little bit about the Achilles tendon, not too much. Foot surgery in non-ambulant patients, the scoliosis, of course, some fractures, and everything based on the considerations from the Lancet article. You have been sitting quite some hours already, so maybe we can skip this one, because this is just figure 4 from the Lancet paper. And the funny thing was that in the first telecom meeting we had agreement on almost all topics, and we only had to discuss a couple of things, and that's the things I will discuss now. But because you were sitting for several hours now, middle of the afternoon, I would ask you to stand up. Yeah, feels good, eh? Feels good. And then, lean a little bit forward. Make a hyperlordosis of your spine. You recognize that position? You only miss tiptoe. So lift your heels 2 centimeters. Okay. You can sit down here again. It's a good exercise. And I hope you felt what I hope you would feel. What did you feel? Which muscle is really strong contracted? The gastroc, yes. Here. Okay, that's only the introduction why I never do Achilles tendon tenotomies in ambulant Duchenne guys. Be very, very careful with Achilles tendon lengthening, because when you lengthen a tendon, you also weaken the muscle, or the maximum power it can give. So when with lengthening of the Achilles tendon, some boys lose their ability to stand. And the most experience we have with this problem is with CP children. In CP, there's a lot of publications about it. For DMD, you can't find it. The greatest risk is to make someone worse. You need your triceps to stand up right. Okay. So we do no surgery during the ambulatory phase, seldom surgery during the early non-ambulatory phase, and sometimes surgery during the late non-ambulatory phase. So operating on feet in a non-ambulatory phase. Who has any experience with that? Very good. Some. So there is some education to gain. Who recognizes this position of a foot? And this is called an equino-varus foot. So for wheelchair-bound boys. Contractures can be painful and will be painful. And they get pressure sores on the lateral side of the foot and on the fifth toe. And very important, these guys are 14, 15, 16 years. They go to high school and can't wear shoes anymore. Or custom-made shoes, and then you can choose between gray and brown, and not special designs or sneakers. After the operation, most of them can wear normal sneakers. What do we do with the operation? And that's very simple. There's an equinus and a varus. So you have to get rid of the equinus and the varus. So you cut the Achilles tendon, equinus, and you cut the posterior tibial tendon, and you get rid of the varus. That's all. It's 10 minutes. I'll come to that back. I will go only into details later. The main problem is that when you correct the foot like this, also the tendons of your flexors of your toes are also on the medial side of your foot. They also always at the narrow angle. So when you correct the foot, the toes will claw. So you also have to release your flexor hallucis and your flexor digitorum in some cases. But we decided during the operation. So often in combination with tenotomy of the toe flexors. And then after the operation, that's a position where you can wear shoes and your foot is plenty great in your wheelchair. Very valuable. Then the scoliosis. This is the group without steroids. That's a group from 2014. That's strange. 2014, and we have a cohort, 88 patients without steroids. And then you see the vast majority develops a scoliosis, and even 3 in 4, more than 30 degrees. So it's terrible scoliosis, even in 2014. And the time in the wheelchair was highly linked with the progression. And you see that 3 to 4, 4 to 5 years, half of the boys develop a scoliosis, especially when they're wheelchair bound. Scoliosis with steroids. The most data are with daily steroids and not on off or 10-10. But we see a decline from about 90% to 20%. And the curves are less severe. So steroids might prevent scoliosis. It's a good idea. This is a very large cohort. That's the global cohort. 836 boys aged 20 plus, you see 80% no scoliosis surgery and 20% had. So we're doing well. The main question, and that's the question which was also raised this morning, in this Kaplan-Meier, it's funny, it's a Kaplan-Meier survival curve. It has nothing to do with the boys dying, but getting scoliosis surgery. Is this curve really upper, or are we just postponing the scoliosis surgery? That's the main question for the next 10 years. And very important, we have a very short window of opportunity to operate these patients. The curves will progress, always. And when they progress fast. So when you see a scoliosis, refer. Because when you make an x-ray, it's 20 degrees of scoliosis. Within half a year or a year, it will progress to 40, 50, or maybe even 60 degrees. Well. And it will progress fast. Bracing is not useful in neuromuscular scoliosis like it is in idiopathic. So early referral to the orthopedics. Because surgery becomes more difficult with postponed referral, lungs and heart problems, and of course your BMI increase. And I think the easiest rule is the rule of 40. So refer before the curve is over 40 degrees, before the BMI is over 40, the ejection fraction is less than 40, or the FEV1 is less than 40. We see terrible complications in scoliosis surgery, and especially in DMD. When you look at all the neuromuscular disease, especially the DMD did worse. 20% have complications, especially wound complication, and also hepatotoxicity. And that is related to the high blood loss during the operation. This is a difficult one. Who knows something about pelvic tilt? It's a very difficult concept, but it's very, very important. When you have a scoliosis, as a compensation, when my spine curves, my pelvis has to tilt the other way to keep in balance. So most of the time, the pelvis is tilt. And you can measure it on the x-ray. And you can just say it's 10 degrees, 15 degrees, 20 degrees. Some people say they can measure it with physical examination. I think the only reliable way is to do it with an x-ray. And then we do some fusion. This is what we call heavy metal. And this one is fused until the sacrum, to the pelvis. So the pelvis is fixed to the hole, or your spine is fixed to your pelvis. Or shall we just stop at L5 and leave a little bit of movement between L5 and S1? Can be nice. But when you have a terrible pelvic obliquity and you don't fuse until the sacrum, the spine is solid, it's in the wrong direction. So you have to fix. But this is the main discussion we had. In the Dutch scoliosis guideline, we say people with severe pelvic obliquity, you have to include the pelvis. In the Lancet review, they said when it's more than 15 degrees. And we don't like the more than 15 degrees, because it's 14 different than 16. So there's some, this is the only thing we have still debate on. These are the standard articles about the outcome of scoliosis surgery in orthopedic journals. You see there's one typing mistake, of course, this must be pre-op. Pre-op is 70 degrees, 15 degrees post-op. Did you count the number of screws? So it's not really surprising that after follow-up 1, 2, 3 years, as long as the metal doesn't break, that the curve is the same. So there's only the measurement error. This one is important because he was quite a lot pelvic obliquity. But after the operation, pelvic obliquity is gone. So maybe it is a reliable option to stop at L5, and maybe the pelvic obliquity will correct after the spinal fusion. But we don't know. This is our main problem. Our literature, the orthopedic literature, focus on technical and radiographic images. But the functional recovery is, of course, much more important. And I think this is one of the most important conclusions from this article, that surgery in patients who had Duchenne DMD with scoliosis improved function and decreased the rate of deterioration of forced vital capacity compared with patients treated conservatively. However, the muscle power and forced vital capacity decreased in both groups. So, don't do scoliosis surgery to prevent pulmonary deterioration. I think this is an important but difficult topic. When you get such a scoliosis, this is not a DMD, this is a CP. When you get a scoliosis like this, with a terrible pelvic obliquity, almost always you get a problem with the hip on the side where the curve is. Because this hip is adducted, and will go out. So you always have to take into account when you look at the scoliosis, also look at the pelvic obliquity, examine the hips, how supple are the hips, are they still able to abduct the hip, and when they can't, maybe you have to do first hip surgery, and after that scoliosis surgery, or do it in one operation, but it's really demanding. That's a research question. This is boy, 13 years old. 1 year later, what happens? Scoliosis is developing? Or maybe it's primary pelvic obliquity? And it's compensatory scoliosis, maybe. The problem is, this is a patient laying on the x-ray table. We never, ever have to, must accept lying x-rays preoperative. Always upright x-rays, AP. So sitting or standing. Because afterwards a fusion was done, and you see one of the parameters is the head is still above the middle of the pelvis. That's what we want for the balance. And also after the operation, it seems to be quite nice. But when you look at the hip is dislocated. And there is residual pelvic obliquity, so this boy is not able to sit and is not able to bend forward. So he will lose his upper extremity function. It's terrible. So this boy was made worse. And then this hip, was it post-operatively out? Or maybe here already? and we can't see it. So also in the pre-op workup for scoliosis surgery, always include the pelvis and the hips. And then I said two words already about the decline in upper extremity function after spine fusion. And when I saw the program, I suddenly realized that the senior author of this manuscript is the next speaker. So I won't go into detail because I'm quite sure she will mention it. And this was for me amazing. What are the compensation strategies for upper extremity function from the spine in the different diseases? And for CP, we know. Neuromuscular diseases, we don't know. We don't know what the compensation mechanisms are in the non-operated patients. And then we operate them, and we don't know if we take the compensation mechanisms away. So I think, more important, I'm sure this is also a new research question. We have to work together. These are some data from our own hospital database. And I hope you can see the difference between stars and bullets. Here are some stars. And where the stars are, there was a fracture. And on the x-axis is the age. And here on the y-axis is the BMD. And of course, when the boys get older, the BMD decreases. That's what we expect. And I put some colors. These are the mobile ones. So we didn't see any fracture in the ambulatory boys. You see some in the early non-ambulatory phase, but the vast majority is in the group which are wheelchair-bound and have a low bone mineral density. So the vast majority of the lower extremity fractures are non-ambulant boys. In the mobile boys, more upper extremity fractures occur because they fall over and break their wrist. And one of the suggestions from the article was, from the Lancet article, from our guidelines, standards of care, was that in a lower extremity fracture, to choose for operation, for early mobilization. And we discussed it with all the pediatric orthopedics, and we're not convinced, let's say it softly. So we would suggest just treat it as any fracture on non-DMD boys. Only expectation is when a long embolization can be prevented by an operation, because operations are also very dangerous. So when we don't have to operate, don't do it. We always have to risk to weigh the benefits between non-operative treatment and operative treatment. Dr. Wong already mentioned this this article. The vertebral fracture assessment. We use the VFA with DEXA for a couple of years now, and this has recently been validated, and it is as good as the lateral X-ray, but with a lower radiation. And we all know the ALARA principle: keep it as low as reasonable acceptable. So we could do, when you have the same results with less radiation, you would choose the VFA. However, in different hospitals, DEXA is not available. But DEXA is also in the standard of care for DMD boys. So every center has to have a DEXA possibility. So they can also make VFA. Very nice pictures. The perioperative team. In the guidelines, they say a cardiologist, pulmonologist, and a physiotherapist. Do we miss someone? I think the most important person is the anesthesiologist. And especially for scoliosis surgery, also your intensive care doctor has to be experienced with DMD. And of course, the physiatrist, the revalidatiearts in het Nederlands, and the occupational therapist, especially when you correct the spine, you have to have adjustment of your wheelchair directly postoperative and not sending home in your old wheelchair and then make an appointment with the rehab center for, after 6 weeks. So the team is more than only the surgeon and the cardiologist and the pulmonologist. And I also would like to emphasize on their own treating team. And that's one of the things which is luckily, in the new guideline for trauma in children, all the fractures, it's advised to refer them to a center, and especially to their own center. So, in summary, all considerations are applicable for the Dutch situation, except we don't do Achilles tendon lengthening in ambulant boys. Maybe we should do some research on it, but I'm quite reluctant to do an Achilles tendon lengthening, so it's very difficult to include someone, and then I have to do the operation which I'm not comfortable with. So it's difficult to do the research, but maybe we can compare groups with, for example, Leuven. Variation between spine surgeons to fuse until L5 or sacrum. And we're just discussing, just accept the variation or make it also a research question. Variation in vertebral fracture assessment, that's only implementation. So we have to discuss it with the different treatment centers, only implement this standard of care. Lower leg fractures, mostly non-operative. I think we still can accept that, or maybe rely on good research. But it's very difficult to find reliable data. And not in all hospitals possible to make sitting spine x-rays. We have to implement it. Okay.
Thanks.